This is my game that I'm making in assembly and DirectX 11. You can build roads and malls, and cars will travel from nodes on the outer areas of the map to the malls. Then they will stay at the mall for a while and then go back. You get money when people arrive, and it costs money to build roads and malls and to maintain them. In this video, I will give an overview of the code of the game. If there is something you would want me to go through in more detail, please leave a comment about it, and I will take it into consideration when planning new videos. Let's go straight to the code. This is the enter point of the program. It starts off with a lot of includes, which includes all the different files. And this first segment here is the data segment. So here we have all the files that are needed for the data of the program in general. Most notably are the structures and variables, which is for most of the data in the program. Is it clear? The next part here is the data question mark segment, which is also known as the BSS section. And here we have uninitialized data. So while the data in the data segment, that will be initialized at assembly time and be part of the binary. The uninitial data will not make the binary larger. And then after that comes the code segment. And these files are all the code files in the project. And after that we have the actual main function. It's called startup in this program. And it's declared in the build script that this will be the function to call while executing the program. So in here, basically, there's all the setup that's needed for the game. Start up with setting up the main window, and by calling a function for that, and below the height map for the terrain of the game, and then a lot of setup for the game objects. And then we set up DirectX and the text, and then we load the game if there's a saved game to be loaded, and a lot of other setup. And here at the end, we actually call the sort of main loop in the program, the run message loop. This is what's gonna keep the program going. And if that ends for some reason, maybe the user exits the program, for example, then we'll end up here and we save the game and then we exit the process. So here's the run message loop function. This is responsible for handling all the events from Windows, such as keyboard and mouse events, and then process them. It's basically the main loop of the program. So it processes the events, and then it runs the update scene function and the render scene function. The update scene function is where we update the state of the game, and the render scene function basically tells DirectX what we want to render this frame. If you take a look at the code here, it's a pretty standard message handling from the Windows API. All these win calls, this is a macro that makes it easier to call Windows win API functions. Basically, so you can just add the registers as parameters for the function. One thing that might be out of the ordinary if you haven't programmed in assembly is the XOR things here. So basically, these are just doing an XOR with the register and itself, which basically sets it all to zero. So it's a fast way to zero a register. So basically, it just calls the peak message method, gets the message data in this local variable, and then checks if there's anything there, and if there is, handles that message. And if it isn't, or after the messages have been taken care of, we basically just run this update and scene and render scene. And we'll have a look at the update scene next. So let's take a look at the update scene function. This is where most of the magic happens. This is responsible for updating the game state, all the updates that are needed each frame. So this is run once per frame before the render method. And to start with, I calculate the delta time since the last frame. Basically by using the Windows API query performance counter, which is a high precision timer the Win API provides. And from that I can get the number of milliseconds, or actually microseconds is what I use, since the last frame. And this can then be used to control any animations or time-dependent updates. A bit further down in this method, there's some code to control the camera. Currently the camera is controlled from the WASD buttons, for position, and you can control the look direction with arrow keys or by the mouse. We're gonna have a look at the code that controls position of the camera. So I have a variable that says whether the W button here, for example, has been pressed or not. If it hasn't been pressed, we just skip all this and move to the next button. But if it has been pressed, we want to get the current position of the camera so we can update it. So we load the current position here in this XMMM4 register. This is the whole VEC4 of the camera position, and then we load the delta time that we calculated before. Then we have a constant that says how far the camera should move each microsecond. Then we read the Y position of the camera, because the camera move speed should be dependent on how close it is to the ground, since if it's very far and very high up, we want to move much faster than if we are very close to the ground. So we use that, multiply it with a constant. Then this instruction will copy that value to all the float parts of the XMM2 register. And then we multiply that with the time value. So now we have how far we should actually move this frame, copy that over there. And then since we press W, we want to move to the direction that the camera is currently looking at. So we move that vector into XMM0 here. And then we do a magic shuffling that basically makes it so we only have the X and Z value left of that vector. The Y and the W is going to be 0, since in this vector the W is 0, and this will basically put X in X and Z in Z, but it will put W in on Y and Z. This is so we only affect the camera in the 2D space, the X and Z space basically. Then we want to normalize the vector, and that this is a macro that normalizes the vector in X and M0. And after we've done that, we can multiply the normalized vector with the length we're gonna move this frame. And then we simply just add this value to the original value of the camera position. And then we write it back to the camera position vector. And then we use the RCX register to tell that we have moved the camera. That's how the camera updates. If we move a bit further down to here, this is where most of the game logic that currently exists happens. So it's divided in different functions to keep it manageable. And basically we have a function, they are quite self-explanatory. Spawn cars are responsible for spawning new cars that has one of the models as its destination. Update car targets is responsible for updating the node target that the car has. So each time the car reaches a node, it needs to know the next node it should have. It's also responsible for the actual path finding for the car, so it will also find the path for the car when it's first spawned. Update car positions basically update the position in the world of the cars, and velocity is self-explanatory as well. Move cars, parking is responsible for parking the cars if they reach the mall destination. And then I have two debug methods here. One that renders debug lines in the intersections, so I can see which intersections are taken to debug that. And this is to find any intersections that have been locked by a car and hasn't been unlocked properly. So both these should not be run, and the game is run properly. They're only for debug purposes. And then here, some code for setting the texts that are shown in the game. And then the maintenance costs basically calculates how much the player needs to pay for maintenance for the roads and the malls they have. And then we update the text displaying the current money. We also update the text that is shown when you want to build something, how much it's gonna cost. And then we have a function that for the traffic light UI, if you select the traffic light, it's a very basic programmer UI for controlling its behavior. And then we update the colors of the traffic light, so they have to make sure they are in the correct state. This was a short overview of the code on my project. If you want me to go through anything you saw into more detail, remember to leave a comment below, or if there's anything else in the project you're interested in knowing more about, and I'll try to make a video about it. And don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss any new videos. There will be new devlogs about the new progress of the game soon. Thanks for watching. Bye.